Hey, team.
It's Klaxoon.
Hey, team. It's Klaxoon.
Hey, team. It's Klaxoon.
Hey, team. It's Klaxoon.
Hey, team. It's Klaxoon.
Hey, team. It's Klaxoon.
Hello and welcome to this latest Klaxoon Live. My name is Charles, and for the next 30 minutes, we'll be exploring new ways of working and the future of work. So, do you do a lot of projects? If you do, you should know that 30% of projects are successful. That means a whole lot of projects go back to the drawing board. And it gets a lot tougher when you have a lot of multi-stakeholders involved. So we have a great guest to talk about projects, ones with that have a lot of people in them in this new normal. And Alan Ryan, he is founder and executive director of the Hargreaves Institute. Alan, how are you?
I'm fine. Thank you very much, Charles.
So what's going on today? Tell us about yourself and tell us about the Institute.
Well, I'm an engineer by training. I spent the first half of my career in manufacturing and the second half of my career in the Institute. The Institute came from the Australian Graduate School of Management in Sydney. We were established in 2006, and we work with large complex organisations, both in Australia and globally, to help them to thrive, collaborate, innovate and grow. And that's our role in life. The simple words, thriving teams, thriving organisations.
And when we talk about this new normal and projects, has there been a trend you've been seeing lately that's kind of surprised you at the Hargreaves Institute? Things that have been put into place that are sort of surprising?
The surprising thing, everyone understands the issue we have with COVID, the move to remote or hybrid or distributed teams. And the big trend that we're seeing is the fact that project teams are either improving their performance and loving the situation, or they're not improving and they're having issues and dramas. And so when we looked at team performance before COVID, we had a bell-shaped curve, and performance was like a bell-shaped curve, as most things are. Now, during COVID, the bell-shaped curve is flattening and widening, maybe even becoming bipolar, where some teams are high-performing and other teams are performing way less.
Okay, well, we'll get all of that a little bit later. Throughout this, if there's questions from any of you that are watching us, please use the Q&A. We'll be happy to answer those in a timely fashion. So for those of you that might not be familiar with Klaxoon, Klaxoon's about all those times that teams come together to collaborate efficiently. And our work days are full of them, right? So from meetings, workshops, trainings, project management, design thinking sessions, all hands. And every single one of those have had to be rethought the last few months as we've gone full remote. With Klaxoon and its collaborative suite of apps, you can simply synchronize and align your teams. Make sure when you have meetings and workshops that there's participation and engagement, and all of those are inclusive. And overall, make sure that teamwork is efficient and effective. Okay, I'd love to hear a little bit more about Hargreaves Institute. And I think you've got this, I think you might share your screen here to give us some
insight. Yeah, I can do that.
Where does it come from? When did it start?
It started, the research work started around 2002. The actual institute started in 2006. And just highlight a little bit of a wonderful lesson is that the institute is named after this gentleman here, Lawrence Hargreaves, who was the first person in the world that had controlled flight without hot air. That happened in Australia in 1894. And he had a philosophy of sharing all his intellectual property. And so you can see here that the Wright brothers flew in 1903, and their plane looked surprisingly similar to what Hargreaves was doing. And then the wonderful thing, and Klaxoon Ping and Charles are based in France, is that Voisin in 1907 was the first commercial manufacturer of aeroplanes based in France, and their first commercial aeroplane was called the Hargreaves. And so, and this is our $20 Australian note that has Hargreaves highlighted on the reverse side of it. And so the big message, we named the Institute after Lawrence Hargreaves, because he believed in sharing. And he also had a weakness, which was he never actually achieved flight, powered flight himself, because he didn't listen. And there were many stories about him not listening. And so the fact that he didn't listen to people who invented things as well as him meant that he fell behind. So even though he led the world in 1894, he did not achieve powered flight, and other people overtook him, not because he collaborated. He shared, but he did not listen. And so we named the Institute after him based on the sharing and the fact that it was done just south of Sydney.
Right. So collaboration is important, and listening is super important. And I want to talk about multi-stakeholder projects. And why are they difficult in general? And maybe for people, everyone at home who aren't familiar with what those are, can you give us an idea of what they look like?
Well, the best way to understand a multi-stakeholder project or a complex project is to understand the opposite, which is a routine project. A routine project, routine teams, you know what you're doing, you know what the outcomes are you're trying to achieve, you have very clear processes and you have very clear deliverables. A complex and multi-stakeholder project, you have lots of people involved, customers, partners, governments, the community. You have lots of ideas, lots of input, lots of conflicts happening, and you don't really know what the outcome is going to be because you're going to develop along the way. And so you know the ultimate goal, but you don't know the actual route. And so these are complex multi-stakeholder projects, and every organization has some, as well as every organization has routine projects. And so we're focusing on improving the performance of complex multi-stakeholder projects.
Why are they difficult?
Well, they've always been difficult. 99% of innovation fails. As you said, 30% of projects fail, only succeed, sorry. And so it's always been difficult. It's just that it's got more difficult. And so we were part of a major survey across Australia a few months ago. And what we actually did was we had 258 responses of chief information officers across Australian organisations that represented 1.5 million workers. And we got the results. We also partnered with Pricewaterhouse. And Pricewaterhouse, let me just make this a bit bigger, they have a performance index. And this is the big story, is that before COVID, the performance of teams was very close around a mean. This is targets reached pre-lockdown. You can see it's very close. Post, during COVID and post-lockdown, the distribution has increased. And so some teams are improving, as you can see it, and other teams are actually dropping off. And that's the big message. The big message is that there's actually this spread of performance. And so that's a global number.
Is there a way to explain this?
I think the way to explain it is really the people side of projects. People have the tools, they have the techniques, they have the goals. But now we're talking about people, and people becoming more and more important. I like to think of the decade of 2010 to 2020 like the technology decade. You know, the iPhone started in 2007. And so this whole decade has been around the development of technology. The decade coming is the decade of people. It's a decade of humans. It's a decade of humans using technology. And so it's humans that actually use the wonderful suite of Klaxoon apps, plugin. That's the next stage. At the moment, we've got this overlap, the overlap where humans are just starting to really fully perform using the technology. Right. So to highlight that, these are the results from Australia. The red is much more difficult and the white is much easier. So the CIOs are telling us the team bonding, team collaboration, team alignment is much more difficult under COVID. And coordinating stakeholder, multi-stakeholder, large projects with multi-stakeholders is the next highest difficulty thing that they're worried about, and they're intrinsically linked. So it's this people-led problem that we've got where we're trying to coordinate not only our teams within a team, we're trying to coordinate between teams, we're trying to coordinate customers and suppliers. And as everyone knows, we're spending far much more time organising appointments and organising our time while we work remotely. And so just the coordination, the talking, the understanding, there's no more water cooler conversations, there's no more chats in the corridor. So this whole complexity around people interaction And I was speaking to a client today, and they said, we're just yearning for social conversations where we just create relationships with our teams. Mm. I think that's really, really important, and that's what's missing. It's that little bit of magic, that people magic that makes projects successful.
But overall productivity's been pretty solid in the last few months, hasn't it?
Yeah, the average productivity is absolutely solid. Productivity in routine work is solid. Productivity in regular activities is solid. Productivity in work you can do by yourself is incredibly solid. In Sydney, where I'm based, you know, you're not doing an hour commute anymore. You're not getting tied up, wasting times with meetings you don't need to go to anymore. So productivity has improved. So the quantity of teamwork has improved. The quality, which we can see in these complex multi-stakeholder projects, is where the issue is, right? Mm-hmm. So it's not quantity, it's quality. And that's where the highlight is.
So those two stats that kind of really pop out, which is the team bonding and the coordinating, do you think they're sort of linked?
They're absolutely linked. And when you do the research pre-COVID, some of the world's leading organizations that were born remote always spent time and money bringing their teams together for face-to-face sessions to create relationships that are face-to-face that they can maintain while they're working remotely, right? You right. create relationships face-to-face and you maintain them when you're working remotely. During the lockdown, we couldn't do that, of course, right? You couldn't bring people together even if you wanted to. And now in Australia anyway, we're coming out of lockdown, but a lot of organizations are not letting their people come to work. A lot of them are still keeping them remote because it's because they're worried about creating another breakout. And so this creating relationships, so there's a big issue in starting teams, rebooting teams to build relationships, and teams solving some problems or conflicts have become a big issue where you just can't get in the room and bang heads together. You know what I mean? You just can't do that human stuff, especially with complex projects where it's about opinions and it's about customer insight that you're trying to uncover and develop as compared to doing a calculation in a routine project.
Well, you might be banging your head because the project isn't going how you want it to go. But I want to talk a little bit about some of the other things that you've been seeing, and most notably about how we're perceiving it as employees and our engagement to our organization, to the projects we're doing. What are you seeing on that front?
Well, we're seeing, and it goes back to the wonderful Richard Branson quote, you look after your employees and the employees will look after the customers, right? Mm. And I think that's the big trend in the fact that now a lot of organizations is focusing on looking after their employees because they're the glue. Every organization's got access to every technology in the world. Every organization has got access to every customer in the world, right? Now the competitive point of difference are your employees. And also your employees can leave your organization and they can go join an organization based in another country and work from home. So good employees have to be well looked after because they can leave and go to another organization. A very good friend of mine works in Canberra but works for, you know, a tech company in the US. And that's his day job, right? And so we have to really look after the and understand and help employees during this time. And in the same way, the other lovely bit of data is that one of our friends does customer engagement, and they've found the same trend in customer engagement in terms of some customers love the companies they're buying from, and other customers have learned to hate them. Mm. The banks in Australia now have got increased churn. People now leave their bank easier, faster and quicker than they ever did before COVID because they're used to change. And so this whole churn of customers has increased. There's going to be, we predict, a churn of employees as stress and people want to leave, et cetera. So, you know, looking after customers is going to become, looking after employees is going to become incredibly important in order for future success.
Do you have some numbers on the employee engagement stuff? Maybe that...
Well, I do. And so we looked at, this is lovely, this is our friends at Gallup. And so this is the data that says in the year 2000, employee engagement was at about 26% engaged. Mm. This is US data, which is pretty comprehensive. And you could see over 20 years that the data was slowly, slowly rising. And everyone was very satisfied that they're slowly improving. And to go from 26 to 38 is like a huge improvement. Then in COVID, and it's not well presented here, but it dropped from 37 to 31 in like 3 months.
Right.
And so employee engagement has dramatically dropped. And so, and this is across huge numbers of people. And so employee engagement was going up and it's now had a huge drop. And I just put in this lovely article that was sent to me as an email today from a major training company. And this is the sort of messaging that you can see, you know, extremely connected teams are more important, but they now spend half their time collaborating, right? What are they doing the other half? Three out of four companies have a permanent shift to employee work, and communicating now takes 80% of employees' time, and people are on twice as many teams as 5 years ago. So this is a huge change. And you know, when it says extremely connected teams are 21% more profitable, unconnected teams are all significantly less profitable. And so I just grabbed that image off an email that popped in my inbox today to show you this change and this churn that's going on with people's side of business at the moment.
Yeah, no, I love these stats and I love this having to wear multiple hats in all these teams. And I think you touched on it before and could be an interesting thing to look at of how we view our teams. If we view them as sort of customers, we become super customer centric and with the strong goal of understanding our customers and what they need and catering to it. And in the same way we do that with our customers, we need to start thinking about that on the employee side, right? Kind of treating it as a customer and having the same way we might have NPS scores and things like that. That might be a good way to sort of stop this downward trend of this disengagement. I'd love to better understand because, you know, we've seen what happened. We've actually all lived it. I think we've all been part of this amazing work from home experiment. So I think we can relate to these stats a little bit and be in agreement with what the study has put out. What are you seeing and what are people saying to you that are doing these type of projects with multi-stakeholders? What are they saying to you and what are some of the solutions you think?
Well, we're actually gathering a lot of data, and I just share a simple model that we found to be incredibly, incredibly valuable. And if anyone here, this is the web address, and you can download it for free. And there's a whole bunch of wonderful information there. So the model, and this is what people are telling us. So what they're saying is that their teams need to be confident and connected. The teams need to be confident in what they're doing, and they need to be connected to themselves and other teams. So that's the two core messages that we're hearing from high-performing organizations. And so confidence comes from autonomy. The team can make its decisions about what it's doing. Competence, that they can actually do what they've been asked to do. And sense of progress, which means they know that they're progressing and they're getting feedback. That gives a team confidence. And we've got to give teams confidence in order to actually get their job done. Then the second area is connectedness. They've actually got to be connected to the organization. So just let me, to help everybody just see the words, I'll make it a bit bigger. Belonging. Your team needs to feel that they're part of the larger organization and they're valued. Trust. The team needs to trust the organization and the organization trusts them and trusts the systems. And finally, you want to engage with others and others want to engage. This is the engagement score. So the Gallup engagement score is just one of the six parameters that drives these successful teams. And so this is really a holistic view of people, right? So it's everything from my skill set, my competence, through to the fact, well, do I trust the systems that I'm working in? You know, will people let me do my job? I've got autonomy to do it. And I feel like I'm part of something bigger. So this gives you this softer people side of businesses, which is what we're hearing. And these are the sort of metrics as well that the leaders are now asking for. So as well as getting the metrics of how much they've sold each day and the turnover of profit and loss and numbers, they're now looking at these types of metrics to actually understand their teams. And that's really building that strong foundation within organizations to understand their teams.
Which one do you start with?
Oh, why do you always ask the difficult questions? Okay. The absolute joy, and I put a post up on LinkedIn about there's not one size fits all, okay? The most important thing is that I'm not going to tell you which one you start with, right? Because you have to start with the one that's most important to you, right? You actually have to ask your team the question, which is the most important to us and how are we doing? Which one are we strong at that we want to get better at, which is an appreciative inquiry approach? Or which one is really holding us back? Every team has to make their own decisions, right? There is no one size fits all. What we know is the best teams for complex, high-performing, multi-stakeholder projects are diverse teams. You want diverse mindsets, diverse people, diverse experiences. And the last thing that we try to do with an organization is say, and you follow these three steps and you do this, right? You have to let the team decide what's the most important thing and then help the team to actually improve, because you want the team to be different, unique, high performing. Every athlete's different, even though they're all running in the 100 meter race or whatever you want to do it, but we have to make sure that we keep diversity. And that's one of the benefits, if you can achieve it under remote working and COVID, is that you can actually have incredibly diverse teams now, because you have teams in many different countries, teams at many different times of the day, teams of people with many different experiences. That's diversity is a huge driver, and that's something we just can't overlook.
I totally agree with you. I'm going to take a question from the audience and invite everyone at home to ask some too. Are there any specific issues involved in projects involving professionals situated in different countries? What do you think about that?
Yeah, sorry, you're asking me rather than the audience? That's a question from the audience, sorry.
Yeah, you're the guy to answer the questions here, you know, so. So are there any specific
I've been very fortunate, and I've had work experience in many, many countries. And the big issue is cultural, right? Is what I think is normal is completely different to what you think is normal. And understanding what is normal, and there's a wonderful book, which is called The Loudest Duck. So Charles, have you heard of The Loudest Duck?
No, I've not read that.
You've not read the book. So no. In Western society, we have a saying that says the squeaky wheel gets the grease, right? So that what that means is that if you're in the Western society, you speak up, you push, you ask, you're a squeaky wheel, and they're the people that succeed. In Eastern cultures, the loudest duck gets shot, right? And so they've learned that if you speak up too much, you get into trouble, all right? And so in the West, you have to shut people up sometimes because they talk too much. And in the East, you've got to encourage people to speak because they've spent their whole life, and it's called your grandmother's voice, right? They've spent their whole life knowing that you're not the loudest duck because sometimes you get your head chopped off, okay? And so one of the biggest issues of diversity is that people are different and we don't want them to be the same, but then you have to understand the culture. You have to understand the mindsets and you have to account for that. But you don't want people to all pretend to be Western, right? You've got to maximize diversity, which makes collaboration even harder. And so one of the messages that we have for people is that you get team members to write up a little instruction book note on their social that says, this is the best way to deal with me. This is how you catch me. I'd like to consider my answers, so give me some time to think. Don't put me on the spot. And so you tell your team members what's the best way to react with you, because you're torn between you want everyone to have a different culture, but it makes it harder to collaborate, right? And so but you've got to keep that difference up there. So culture is the driver of performance and collaboration.
How do you level the playing field in those cases? You know, let everyone, you know, where cultures that might be more reserved to be able to participate and stuff like that. How does a tool maybe like Klaxoon or some of the other things that you've seen be helpful in sort of level the playing field where everyone can take part, everybody can participate, and make sure that you don't have these automatic barriers that pop up that are borders, but also the culture of an organization or the culture of leaders?
So two things. The power of tools like Klaxoon is you can have asynchronous meetings. You can have meetings that people work on a board at the meeting, between meetings, And so the power is that if somebody is takes a little bit of time to think or wants to consider or wants to think through or aren't happy to put things up in front of everybody else, they can work asynchronously, okay? So the absolute power is that people can work asynchronously. The other absolute power is that a lot of time people listen to interrupt. You know what I mean? Like you ask a question and all you're doing is listening to find a reason to interrupt the other person, right? And so the power of having a board where you ask everybody to put their idea up and everybody to share is you're not actually listening, right? And so some of the best things about using a Klaxoon board is you can do it quietly. You know, you can actually do it in silence so that you're not actually got, because yes, for every person that's a quiet mouse, there's a loud mouth, right? And just because you're a loud mouth doesn't mean you're right, okay? And so therefore, the fact that you can work asynchronously, the fact that even if you've got everybody in the room, you can actually work quietly. You can also then say, we would like everybody to put a post on the board and then divide them into small teams to discuss it and then divide them into to discuss it and then bring them back all together means that you can really get engagement because you don't want 100% of the people in the room. You want 100% of the people engaged in contributing in the room on the board. You know, and we've done surveys and I think everyone's seen them where you ask people if they've gone to a meeting and whether they said anything or not, right? Or you ask people if they've gone to a meeting and they had something to say and they didn't say it, right? That's the culture of the organisation. And so using a visual board where people can work asynchronously, they can work quietly, and more importantly, they can work to an agenda, right? So the thing I like about visual boards and Klaxoon is that just because it's a whiteboard doesn't mean there's a process, right? Mm. You can have an absolute process. You can be following a process, do this, do that, do this. And the participants today can see, you know, that we've followed a process, right? We've actually put a lot of information on the board and we went through a process, right? And we planned out our conversation. You can actually have a very rigorous process on a Klaxoon board or on a whiteboard or whatever you want to do. So it's got that lovely mix of creativity and process. Hmm. And I think that's really, really important to get everybody involved. So I just put up, so there's some free resources that we've got that anyone would like to copy down the links to them. There's a packet of resilience cards for individuals. There's some digital team building cards that they, both resilience cards and digital cards work on Klaxoon boards brilliantly. We've got a face-to-face workshop if people bring their teams together. But as we sort of, we promised everybody half an hour, Charles, I've got to finish with this, right? I'm not allowed to not. And I think you'll remember this famous quote from Albert Einstein, you know, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results, right? My quote for the new decade is that insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting the same results. Because the world is changing so fast around us that what we did yesterday is not going to be good enough, right? And so that's what the next 10 years is going to be about.
Hmm. And how should our leaders be thinking about these new projects, the projects that's coming tomorrow, coming next month, when we know that there's, you know, things are going to continue this way, right? We're going to be working remotely. We're going to be having a lot of global collaboration and people from different backgrounds and different parts of the organization being plugged in. How do we get going in the right way? How do we start off on the right foot for all these new projects that are coming down in the pipeline?
So I'll answer the question in two parts. Before you start a project off on the right foot, please make sure you've got a continuous improvement loop, that you know how you're going to measure the performance of the project and continually improve the people, the teams as you go. So you've got to have a measurement and continuous improvement loop. Every 3 months you get people together, talk about the project, but have a continuous improvement loop. The first answer to your question is you're building a team, and I hate using sporting analogies, but sporting teams, football teams, tennis, whatever, they spend many, many more hours practicing than they do actually delivering. And in business, we spend many more hours delivering than we do spend practicing, right? So starting new projects, please invest some time in building the team. Please invest some time in the team practicing. Please invest time in giving the team a continuous feedback loops, right? Because if you've got a team of 20 people and you can improve their performance 5% by using good team, that's an extra person. You get an extra person on your team because everyone's 5% better. And what we can see, you can actually get 30% better or 20% better. That's like four or five people on your team. That's an awful lot of money you save, but more importantly, you'll get the project done quicker, right? Because nowadays, there's no shortage of money in most organizations. There's no shortage of ideas. What there is shortage of is time and the fact that whatever we're doing going forward, our projects have to be delivered faster, right? And we can't go back on time. So when we delay things, we're shooting ourselves in the foot. So please invest time in building a great team and then make sure the team's got the best tools possible, right? Give them the best tools, because if a team is trying to climb Mount Everest and they just haven't got the best tools, right, that's the absolute key message, is spend time building your team, spend time continually improving your team, and give the team the best tools, hire the best players, and then let them. And I suppose the last thing I'll finish on is, and then a leader should get out of the way, right? Yeah. Let the team do its work. Don't look over its shoulder, stop it from doing things, wait for approvals. Let, you know, if you've got a team, empower them to do the work.
That's sound advice, I think. Great what you're saying. There's a question just on the book you mentioned a bit earlier, the title of the book. The person did not catch that.
Oh, that's a good question.
The duck book, is that the one you mentioned?
Oh, The Loudest Duck.
The Loudest Duck.
The Loudest Duck.
Okay.
Right, Loudest Duck, it's about culture. It's The Loudest Duck. You just type in Loudest Duck and you'll find it. So one of the key things that we now focus on is, remember, you've got to maximize diversity and it's going to make it really hard to collaborate. And that's just the joy of life. So please maximize the diversity and then really focus on collaborating better.
Great. This has been a lot of fun. Thank you for taking the time. And I think I would invite everyone to visit maybe some of the things that you've said. Where can they get a hold of you quite easily to learn more?
Well, I didn't put the link up, but you know, I'm Alan Ryan with two L's, A-L-L-A-N. You'll easily find me on LinkedIn, and I connect with everybody that I can. That's LinkedIn. My organization, Hargraves Institute. If you follow us on LinkedIn, then you get all our content. We have a group called Hargraves Community that you're more than welcome to join as well. But we believe in sharing it because we receive a lot of good stuff. So our website, hargraves.com.au, has a lot of free tools, has a lot of free things. And so please go to hargraves.com.au. It's spelt that way, hargraves.com.au. Lots of free stuff there. We have a monthly newsletter. Connect up to the monthly newsletter. Whether you're obviously in Australia or Asia or Europe, we're more than happy to share our intellectual property with you. And listen.
Alan, this has been wonderful. For everyone at home, I invite you. I know this has been challenging, and the stats have shown this. We don't have time to put everything on pause. So we do have to work better together as a team and make sure that global collaboration is working right. So I invite everyone to maybe try out Klaxoon to help you out on these projects and when you're working remotely. And when you're doing collaboration and teamwork in general. So visit us on klaxoon.com. There is actually a free trial that you can try to see if this works for you. If you need to work asynchronously, as Alan was saying before. Alan, again, wonderful. One of the things that's important at Klaxoon is that it's powered by teamwork, everything that we do and all the success we have with customers in 120 countries. So I want to give a shout out to my colleague, Sebastian here, who's in the background and you won't see him, but he's been a great teammate here for on all these Klaxoon Lives. So I thank him. So Alan, once again, this has been wonderful. I can't wait for our next chat. Everyone that's joined us at home, thank you so much. Klaxoon out.